Much for the invitation to be here and the excuse to talk about fanzines. I'm really going to talk to you today about being a collector of fanzines as opposed to being an academic looking at fanzines as objects, although some of that will slip into my talk. I don't doubt that. I also want to pick up on some of the things that Michael Johnson was talking about yesterday and also what Wolfgang was talking about this morning. And I think in particular, when we talk about DIY or do-it-yourself, it's absolutely key that that word fun comes into play. That I think if you can't enjoy doing it yourself, then why are you doing it at all? And I think that's really, really important. So I hope that some of that funness comes out in the images that I'm going to be showing you today. I'm going to do this in two parts, and it was very, very difficult to pull these slides together of the different kinds of fanzines that I'm going to be showing you, mainly because I've got several thousand in my collection, and as any good designer knows, when you start to make decisions about large bodies of work and your favorite poster or your favorite typeface or whatever it happens to be, you agonize for days on end, which is exactly what I did. So I just, by chance, threw some things together. I'm not quite sure if I remember what I've put up here, but nonetheless, I think it'll be quite interesting. It's about the spontaneity of the message as well. So we'll get a little bit of that across today as well. I am also very interested in looking at the notion, again, what Wolfgang was talking a little bit about, of about craft, and also about moving from something which is about immediacy to intentionality. And I think that's a really important aspect when you're looking at the history of fanzines, that you're moving from something that is seemingly quite spontaneous and immediate and accessible in its message to something which begins to use different kinds of production techniques, which slows down the process from the producer's standpoint. It slows down the making, and it's a much more intentional act. And that resulting effort is very much visible in the form of the zine, but also in terms of the kind of production methods and what they're trying to communicate. So hopefully I'll get a little bit of that across today as well. Now, when I do these talks, I'm always really interested in a show of hands. And I have to ask, how many of you have actually, hand on heart, produced a fanzine? Great. We've got a few here. Excellent. I'd love to talk to you afterwards about that as well. For those of you that are not producers of fanzines, how many of you are actually readers of fanzines? The number got smaller there. Okay. How many of you actually know what a fanzine is? Okay. Great. A little bit better there. Just to kind of start off, and Peter.
Sorry? Don't know what a fanzine is.
Well, I'll tell you what a fanzine is, Peter. A fanzine is very much, if you think of it as a conflation of the term fan and magazine. So fanzine coming together. It's a publication that's put together by people who are incredibly passionate about a subject. They are amateur publications in the main, although we will see historically that does begin to shift. They are non-professional in that kind of sense of the amateur aspect. They're independent. They're kind of outside the mainstream in terms of magazine publication. They tend to vary in print runs. Some of the zines that we'll be looking at, only maybe a dozen have actually been produced. Others have been put onto photocopy machines, and thousands have been produced. We'll look at Sniffing Glue very briefly, which started off only with 50 being run for its first issue, but by its 14th issue, there were close to 15,000 being run off. So it really does vary. The distribution, again, is pretty much outside the conventions of mainstream publishing. It's through word of mouth. Those of you that have ordered fanzines before, if you've heard about them, you've gotten in touch with the producer, you've sent through the post in your self-addressed stamped envelope your 50 pence wrapped up carefully on a piece of cardboard with your scotch tape around it so that it doesn't look like there's any money actually in the envelope. It gets to the producer, and at some point in the next year or two, you might actually get something in return. But of course, what you do get back is a very carefully crafted, a lovingly produced production, and very much worth the wait. And if you're lucky, you also get a letter back from the producer thanking you for having to contribute to their interest area, and pleased to respond back to them with any feedback. So already you're beginning to see this relationship between the producer and the reader, between the person who's putting this together and the other person who's receiving it on the other end. It's a reciprocal relationship. Now, fanzines are very much less concerned about, again, the conventions of grammar, of punctuation, of spelling. Talking to a group of designers, it's very much about being outside the use of grids and kind of conventional layouts. It's kind of stirring it up a bit, and it's really about pulling these things together to communicate to those like-minded individuals. Now, the two quotes I have here, one from Frederick Wortham, who was very key in publishing in the 70s a book about fanzines, so it's one of the very first ones. But I just liked his very succinct definition of it being a special form of communication, and I really do think it is that. It is something quite unique. Stephen Duncombe, who again is one of the first academics out of the U.S. to actually contextualize fanzines from a political and historical position, looks at them as these little publications filled with rantings of high weirdness and exploding with chaotic design. Again, I think this is very appropriate, especially for some of the early punk fanzines, which I'll be showing you. So, how available are these things? Where do we find them? Are they really out there? Are they very much about being below critical radar and under the mainstream aspects of Waterstone's bookstore? They are found in independent record stores. They are found, as I said earlier, in terms of word of mouth. You can find them in indie record shops. More importantly, you can find them at fanzine fairs and symposia. And it's very fortuitous that on Saturday there's actually one in the East End of London. So if you're really keen to find out more about it, you can go to London Zine Symposium and find more details about that. But just to give you an idea of scale, because I think this is quite important as well, because oftentimes you think fanzines, well, they're small productions, and therefore, with their limited runs, they're just kind of being hidden away. They're not visible in the mainstream. But in the 1980s, the Guardian newspaper actually reported, for you football fans out there, that there's actually 10,000 titles in the UK alone of football fanzines. And that's just in one subject area, one area of interest. In terms of what was happening in the States in the early 1990s, Time magazine actually reported that there were 20,000 titles in the US. And other people have reported that at Tower Records, which is a now defunct record store that began in the States, that in 1 month alone, over 4,000 titles were sold in the early 1990s. So already you're beginning to see this is a little bit more than a couple people sitting in their back bedroom or on the kitchen table producing these fanzines, that it's actually quite a widespread activity. So why is this interest on the increase? Well, I think part of it has to do with self-empowerment. It has to do with being able to take something in terms of a concept from the beginning right through to the end to actually handing it over to your reader and making a connection with the reader, with the audience themselves. It's about expressing yourself in relationship to a community, and I think one of the things I'd like to talk about today is very much about the DIY community and what that actually means. It's part of a do-it-yourself ethos. It's also a very cheap medium. You can do it on a photocopier. Now we've got desktop publishing, and you can print it out. So you can widely circulate these publications quite quickly. So again, we've got the immediacy of the message getting out there. Now, zines have also been the platforms for people who are interested in moving into either graphic design, typography, and also mainstream journalism. And there are areas where, again, coming back to Wolfgang, there are areas of experience, areas about exploration, where people can begin to look at different ways of doing things and fine-tuning their craft. And some of the names that we see in the mainstream today, I mean, Liz Fairley just raised her hand, being a producer of a fanzine. We also have people like John Savage, who you often see in connection with any programs on punk. He started off with a fanzine that he produced called London's Outrage during the 70s. Danny Baker, who you probably hear on BBC Radio, started off working with Mark Perry on Sniffing Glue. You have other people such as Fred Deacon from Airside, and I'll show you his early fanzine that he did with his sister Camilla, who was a journalist for The Face, very much active in this country in the 80s and early 90s in pop culture. You have other fanzines that have moved in from being a fan publication to a proper magazine with proper distribution. Giant Robot in the U.S. is one which deals with Asian American pop culture, and you've got Cheap Date, which deals with fashion. Its editor is now one of the top stylists for Vogue magazine in New York. And you have, of course, When Saturday Comes, which has still managed to maintain its zine-ness to it after starting off in the late 80s in relationship to football fans. So that's the kind of context in terms of some of the kind of positioning of what fanzines happen to be. And now I'll show you what they actually look like. I wanted to start off with some of the early fan productions, and I think one of the specialist areas that many people gravitated to in the 1930s and 40s in particular was the world of science fiction. And this fanzine, New Worlds, is quite important in that not only was it publishing some of the best known names in science fiction fanzine writing at the time, but its cover was done by an unsung hero of British painting and graphic design, Harry Turner. And he's somebody, I think, that was quite key in the science fiction community in the UK in particular, and he produced a number of covers and illustrations for these science fiction publications. So this is New Worlds, 1939. Space Times, which is another Harry Turner cover, and then Heroes Unlimited, which is a comic zine looking at the future. And I wanted to include this one because its artist was actually looking at the Library of the Future, which was about, instead of taking books out, you would take out these androids which had communication and all the information you needed. So you weren't necessarily reading books anymore, but you were talking with these individuals. Now, music is probably the biggest area that's familiar to us in relationship to fanzine production. And this is an early one called Crawdaddy out of the U.S., done by Paul Williams. And it was really one of the first rock and roll fanzines. And this is something which began quite well before publications like Rolling Stone started. So already people who were interested in music journalism were coming to terms with how you write and how you critique some of the ideas about the bands of the day. And you'll also notice as we go through in terms of the production processes, this one was photocopied, stapled seems to be the more common way in these early productions to actually bind the fanzine together. They tended to run anywhere from maybe 6 pages to 12 pages at the most. They were, you know, fairly thin but highly packed and very dense with information, both visually and in terms of content as well. I'm skipping through history quite quickly because I want to get really to what's going on at the moment. This is Jamie Reed's Suburban Press, which was very much situationist inspired, so looking back to more of an art tradition in relationship to politics and communication, very much about agitprop and anti-design language, but again, still using the production techniques and making those a feature in relationship to the dot pattern itself becoming very integral to what the publication was actually saying. This one is perhaps the best known, and really for this country, set the stage for all of the fanzine producers afterwards, and that's Sniffin' Glue. And this was done by Mark Perry with various others along the way, as I said earlier, with Danny Baker, and looked very much at the emerging punk scene. It only ran for 14 issues. It was a very short-lived publication, but again, one of the few that really began to make an impact in terms of what punk was about, what the lifestyle was about, and as a social document, an actually key publication in terms of our understanding of history. But here again, you have some of the characteristics of the hand-drawn lettering, the use of typewriters, of course, that have a missing key or the character is filled in some kind of way to give it a notion of being very independent and from a single producer. The use of images either appropriated from other music publications at the time, or in the case of Sniffin' Glue, Jill Firmanowski being one of the prime photographers of the period, contributing to the publication itself. They look great on my screen. Okay. It wants to be purple, but it's actually a very light photocopy blue on my screen, so use your imagination. This one I put in for Catherine. It's a Brazilian punk fanzine, but the image is a Gary Panter illustration, so it's been appropriated from the American illustrators and comic artists' own work. And the next one, when we get into the 80s, so the 70s about, you know, primarily the punk movement, moving into the 80s where we're actually looking at consumption. And Beer Frame was one of the kind of seminal publications coming out of the U.S. at the time. And it was very much about Paul Lucas, who was the producer out of New York, looking at a critique of consumer culture and products. So what you begin to get is moving outside of conventional music journalism, looking more at popular culture and lifestyle, and in the 1980s in particular, with the whole rise of consumer culture being much more in your face. The fanzine producers were taking political positions and actually commenting about the act of capitalism from a political position. This one I mentioned earlier is Cheap Date by Kira Joliffe, who has gone on to write books on the subject of styling and works for Vogue magazine. And this is Camilla and Fred Deacon's fanzine, which dealt with the whole kind of rave and dance culture in this country, and it was an opportunity for Fred to very much try out some of the kind of more psychedelic, colorful aspects of his graphic style. And I think, as Michael was saying yesterday, that Airside has always kind of spread itself across a range of different mediums and innovative practices, and this is one of the kind of key early pieces that Fred was involved with. This is one of my favorite, Guinea Pig Zero. Its producer is very much a human subject for testing in terms of laboratory. So instead of being the guinea pig as an animal, it's actually in the U.S. the number of people that are the actual guinea pigs for various pharmaceutical testing. And its producer, Robert Helms, did this for a number of years as a way of critiquing the pharmaceutical and health system and the drug-related aspects of the medical profession, and has a long-standing publication which comments on that. And this one, moving into the 90s, very much about Riot Girl, looking back to punk and some of the original ideas in terms of a collage aesthetic, but also in terms of its situationist-inspired roots, with this Guy Debord image being used on the front cover of Dancing Chicks. Those of you that know my work, this is an area that I'm really interested in, so I'm only going to show one zine today, and perhaps can talk to you later if you're more interested in looking at the kind of rise of new feminist activity through the fanzine publication. Now, for the next 5-10 minutes or so, I want to look more specifically at what's going on today in terms of contemporary zine production. And I think one of the most exciting things about what the zine DIY community actually does is bring people together in relationship to the kind of craft aspects. And these are two photographs from the Boston Zine Symposium, which took place a couple of years ago. But even I like that notion that you're not just someone who goes and picks up a zine, takes it home and reads it, but you can actually go to the paper cut zine library if you didn't want to purchase the fanzine and check these publications out and have a look at them as well. And this is all part of the kind of zine fair or the zine symposium activity, which pulls all the producers and the readers together in various locations. And this happens all the way around the world. Every city tends to have a zine symposium at the moment. So really that celebration of self-publishing. This is one that took place in London a couple of years ago, again in the East End. This is a designer and architect and others who have come together but have used the fanzine as a mechanism for bringing communities together and engaging people in local discussions about local issues. And of course, in order to do a zine, somebody needs to tell you how to do a zine. So there are a number of publications. This one, Stolen Sharpie Revolution, is perhaps the most known. It's now, believe it or not, I think in its third printing, came out of Portland, Oregon. And it's a way of being able to disseminate the kind of tricks of the trade in terms of fanzine production, what kind of techniques to use, what kind of photocopiers to use, and so forth. But I think at the moment it's very much about what has been termed as craft activism, where people are very much taking control of production, not only in terms of fanzines, but for example, guerrilla gardening and other activities of their lives, you know, how to make soap or how to make candles, and kind of returning back to that activity where you are in complete control of your own life and having fun and enjoying it at the same time. Mixtape is out of Australia and is very much a how-to zine in relationship to sewing, to knitting, to crocheting, so very much about the kind of craft activities. This next one is for you filmmakers, How to Make a Super 8 Film. Comes out of Canada and is actually put together by a cooperative of filmmakers. But again, gives you a step-by-step guide to how to make your own film. This one, if you're into political activism, Cut and Paint, is a collection of different kinds of stencils that you can actually take and go out onto the streets and spray paint or paint on to the walls of the street itself. Again, it's the zine itself is moving away from the much more photocopied aspect that we saw in the 70s into something which is about letterpress, it's about printmaking, it's about pulling in other kind of craft production techniques to make a product which is a little bit more about a knowingness, an intention, in relationship to some of the things it wants to communicate. This is a project that we did down at LCC, Lenox College of Communication, called The Memory Cloth, where we worked with a group of artists and designers working in letterpress as well as photocopying. And more importantly, we were working with the local community groups, the Bengali Women's Group, the Senior Citizens Group around the Elephant and Castle, where we spent a day actually making a fanzine. And at the end of the day, it was all sewn up in this nice little bag, and everybody who participated got to take the copy away with them as an aide memoir of the activities that we had in relationship to craft practices during the day. So it's a way of bringing people together. It's a way of engaging on a level which is a little bit more accessible to people who are coming from non-design or non-writing backgrounds, as a way of kind of pulling people together. One of the last slides I have here is for Fever Zine. And again, that notion of where graphic design fits into the equation. This is done by Simon Wybray, a graphic designer with Alex Zamora, who's a music journalist and critic. And they've put together this the Fever Zine. And I think what's quite interesting about this is they've actually embraced new technologies as well. So they've got a print zine, but they also have Flickr sites, they Twitter, they've got a website. They've used all the social networking media in relationship to the print zine itself. So it's not negating one kind of technology over the other. But I think this kind of way of the hybrid of communication is something which is quite interesting to look at, and a way that I think many of the new young zine producers on the scene are actually engaging with these different kinds of mediums as a form of communication. Now, the last slide I want to leave you with is DIY or Don't We? And this is a zine that comes out of the States, out of Olympia, Washington, which is very much about telling the stories of other community group activities. So it's a zine about communities. And I just like that notion that it's not just about an individual zine producer, but it's about ways of bringing communities together and disseminating, again, the activities of the communities themselves through the publication. And in this particular issue, they're talking about communities which include the Cambodian society in the U.S. To the pumpkin farms in the U.S. as well. So different kinds of communities and what that actually means in terms of do-it-yourself design. So I just want to leave with you a couple of thoughts in terms of what DIY actually means, and it's important, its importance to a number of the zine producers and to us as well. They are social, historical, and cultural documents. They're absolutely key in terms of understanding that moment in time. It is that particular slice of what's going on and for an individual's lives and how they're seeing the rest of the world. DIY zines are very much about empowerment and giving the producer control over the message that they want to communicate, not only through the written form, but through the visual form as well. The zines builds community, and I think that's very, very key in terms of how zinesters, as they're called, come together to disseminate their ideas. It's about making one's life your own life. It's about that holistic aspect of producing zines. And face it, you really have to say that zines are just plain fun. Thank you very much.
Anyone got any questions for Teal? Yes, there we go.
They do vary in format, and thanks for pointing that out. They move from A5, A4. You'll get even smaller, what they're called little mini zines, which are a couple inches by a couple of inches. You also get broadsheet size fanzines as well. So, yeah, the format does change quite considerably. The standard tends to be A5, A4.
Hello. How has the popularity of blogging and, you know, other forms of electronic self-publishing influenced the content and purpose of these things?
Blogging and website activity. In the late 80s, early 90s, there was a real surgence in online activity, like with most areas. And what you will find now is a lot of Zinksters are blogging, but I think what's important is it hasn't replaced the print production, that what they're now doing is using their blogs and their websites as a way of supplementing what they're talking about in the print activity. In terms of the kind of writing approach and its kind of authorial position, I think it's very similar, because I think many of the zines are produced, the print ones, quite quickly, and it's about, you know, getting those ideas down and your thoughts down rather quickly, as does the blog, you know, when you're blogging away. So I think the stylistic approach has been the same. I think they're working in conjunction with each other. And I think a lot of Zinesters who had websites early on, many of those people have now just put the websites up for a way of, here I can be contacted and send me your 50p. But the zine is actually appearing in print. And you will get some of the zines now going into PDF files. So again, they're using the internet as a way of providing a wider access to those productions. But I think it's been interesting. There was that kind of, you know, immediacy of you know, the websites and the blogging going up. But I think it's really leveled out. And if you go to these zine symposium, I mean, you see hundreds of zines, you know, in the space of a day. So the print form has definitely not gone away.
I mean, is it mainly sort of fanzine fans who are buying fanzines? I mean, because I wonder how a sort of a newcomer would get into that. See, I mean, nowadays, if somebody can type in, you know, irreverent football gossip into an internet, you know, search, then that's what they'll get back, and they won't necessarily sort of find out, you know, sort of the equivalent of when Saturday comes. I mean, is it a very sort of, you know, a closed shop? And also, shouldn't really ask two questions, but have there been any sort of mainstream breakouts, like lots of blogs have been published, you know, in books, you know, Christmas books and gift books, stuff like that, often novelty things. What about that here?
Yeah. In terms of have the kind of the zine activity gone wider into the mainstream, you can now find a number of anthologies of zine writing, and that you can find in Waterstones bookstore without any problem. In answer to your first question, in terms of it being a closed shop, I think, yes, it still takes a little bit of a, you know, snooping around to trying to figure out where to find the fanzines, but I think it's much more accessible now. I think, as I said, if, you know, London Zine Symposium has a website that's up all the time with annual activities. The Women's Library has an event in June, which is looking at zines in relationship to feminist issues historically. So that they are kind of coming out into the more mainstream. You can go to the Tate and, you know, make a fanzine now for one of your Saturday activities. So it really is much more out there. On that point as well, there are what they call metazines, which are essentially magazines about fanzines. And Broken Pencil in Canada is probably one of the strongest ones at the moment and the most visible. And they do have a website which has a blog on it as well. Fact Sheet 5 was the really early one that Zeth Friedman and Mike Gunderloy were editors of, that really kind of kicked off the whole notion of the magazine about zines.
Yep. Thank you very much, Teal.